I'm so pleased that we're able to begin this morning's discussion about the work that's being done to increase the number of students who are interested in pursuing careers in coding and computer science. Arkansas Governor Asa Hutchinson is already making significant inroads in this area, but I think the combination of panelists that we have here today will give all of our states some additional ideas and resources for how they might apply some best practices in their own initiatives. Moderating this morning's discussion is Linda Hoke. Linda is the director of the Consortium of University Public Service Organizations and has over three decades of experience in economic development, research, and policy. Over 20 years at the Southern Growth Policies Board service as director of the Council on Southern Community, she played key roles in writing each of the organization's reports on the future of the South, including the final report titled Reimagining Workforce Development. She also created and managed Southern Growth's public involvement process known as Listening to the South, and continues to work with the Kettering Foundation to engage citizens in deliberation around important public policy issues. Linda received her BA from Northwestern University and her Master's of Regional Planning from the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Linda, thank you, and we look forward to the panel discussion. Thanks.
Thank you, Diane. I'm pleased to be with you here today. To set the stage for our discussion this morning, I wanted to start with a brief quiz. And so probably you're going to wish that you had stayed at the breakfast table, but I assure you it's not a very difficult quiz. Women make up about 47% of today's workforce. So I'd like to see a show of hands. How many of you think that women make up 47% of today's computing workforce? Okay, we have one taker there. All right, very brave. That's not the correct answer, so let's go on. How many of you think that women make up 30% of today's computing workforce? Let's see a show of hands on that. Okay, I've scared you now. But you're right. Actually, women make up nearly half of today's total workforce, but only about a quarter or a little over a quarter of today's computing workforce. And Hispanics and African Americans are similarly underrepresented in this particular field. And if you combine gender and ethnicity, we're looking at even lower numbers. So in today's computing workforce, about 3% of positions are held by African American women and about 2% by Hispanic women. So we're fortunate to have a great panel to talk with you this morning about these important issues and to talk about some of the initiatives that are helping to address these gaps. So I want to leave plenty of time for our panelists. I think they have a lot of great information to share with you. So without further ado, I'm going to be turning to our first panelist, Hadi Partovi. Hadi is an entrepreneur and investor and also co-founder of education nonprofit code.org. Hadi began his career during the browser wars in the 1990s when he was Microsoft's group manager for Internet Explorer. This led to a career as an entrepreneur, where he was on the founding teams of TellMe, which was acquired by Microsoft in 2007, and iLike, which was acquired by MySpace in 2009. Hadi is an active angel investor and startup advisor with a portfolio that includes Facebook, Dropbox, Airbnb, Zappos, and many others. Please join me in welcoming Hadi Partovi.
Thank you so much, Linda. I had a few slides I wanted to present to talk about the importance of computer science education in America's public schools. Most people who talk about nonprofits talk about a problem they're trying to solve. We talk much more about the opportunity we're trying to unleash for our country. I start usually my talks with a quick story. This is a picture of myself and my twin brother when we were growing up. And my life arc changed, that's me on the left, but my life changed when my dad brought home a computer, a Commodore 64, and he said, you know, this doesn't have any games or programs on it, but here's a book. If you learn how to program it yourself, you can make your own games. And so when I was very young, I started learning how to do this on my own, and by the time I was, you know, 12 or 13, I was able to get summer jobs as a computer programmer when my buddies in school were bussing tables or working at gas stations, and I was well on my way to living the American dream. And, you know, the American dream has changed a lot in the last few hundred years. It's no longer about going out west or building a log cabin or digging for gold. The American dream these days really is about how you can build amazing companies and change the world and impact things with technology. And technology these days impacts every field. It used to be about computers and laptops, and you know, when I got started in this field, that was basically what technology was about. But these days, with the advent of smartphones, technology is impacting everything, whether it's medicine, whether it's smart thermostats and energy, whether it's space exploration, entertainment, things like self-driving cars, or even contact lenses that you put in your eyes that have computers in them. There's not a single field that isn't being impacted by technology. So going back to my story, I want to talk about two other kids who should and could have similar life arcs as myself. This one here is Armand. He goes to school in Washington Park in Harlem, just north of Harlem, a very urban, underprivileged school district. None of the kids in these schools have any access to computer science as a field. This here is Rahel in South Seattle in a school district called Highline, also an almost urban school district, underprivileged students. None of those schools teach the course for computer science. These kids, unless somebody else comes and intervenes, will have no chance of getting on the same track that I got as a kid. And you know, I asked myself, you know, I got into this field 30-something years ago. What does a career look like for a student starting kindergarten today, graduating, you know, by 2030? I used to say that unless you want to get a career, you know, flipping burgers or driving a truck, you're going to need to learn something about how technology is going to impact your field. So it now turns out there's already robots that flip burgers, and there's already trucks that drive themselves. These aren't yet operational, but for sure by the time today's kids are trying to get jobs, they will be in the workforce out there. So, you know, there's a question of can our public system of education evolve? Now, I represent an organization called code.org. People assume that my message is that our kids should be learning to code. That's actually not my message. My real message is that our schools should be teaching computer science. And people also assume that computer science education is on the rise. They assume, you know, there's this amazing growth in this field and these tech companies and all this stuff you read about. Computer science education must be growing. The reality is computer science education is on the recent recovery after 10 years of decline. So during the same time as companies like Google went public and Facebook was founded, the number of graduates in this field has been declining, and the number of women in the field is half of what it was 10 years ago. So this is not a field that is naturally keeping up with the growth and the economic prospects and so on. It's going in the opposite direction. People also assume, you know, I'm here to talk about jobs because the tech industry is desperately trying to hire computer programmers in California. It actually turns out every industry is desperately trying to hire computer programmers everywhere. Just to give a few stats about this, the picture in Arkansas, I'm just going to run through some of the SGA states. In Arkansas, there's currently 1,800 open jobs in computing, and last year there were 250 computer science graduates. If you switch to Kentucky, currently 3,500 open jobs this month, 300 computer science graduates last year. If you look at Georgia, 23,000 currently open jobs, just over 1,000 graduates last year. In Virginia, 32,000 current open jobs, 1,200 graduates last year. In Texas, 43,000 open jobs, less than 2,000 graduates last year. If you look at the whole country's picture, the projection over 10 years is 1.4 million jobs, new jobs getting created, and 400,000 graduates in the field. So this is a huge delta between opportunity and you know, what our current students are graduating in schools. Now, people hear me talk about this and they automatically see, oh yes, STEM, we need more kids going into STEM. And you know, STEM is important. Although one thing I would say for anybody here who makes public policy is that the word STEM is something that 70% of Americans don't even know what it stands for. So if you ever want to talk about STEM, I would try to spell it out. But much more importantly, the STEM problem is in computer science. If there's one thing I show you today, I have two most important charts to show. One is this one. 67% of all new jobs in STEM are in computing fields. And meanwhile, only 8% of university graduates across all of STEM are in computer science. There's a huge mismatch, but the job opportunities in STEM are in computer science, two-thirds of them, more than two-thirds. The other thing that people assume is that, well, because of these jobs, computer science is vocational, And my real message is that computer science is foundational. I bet everybody in this room, when they went to school, when you went to school, learned about things like how the inside of your digestive system works, or how electricity lights up a light bulb, or how the Pythagorean theorem works. And probably none of you ended up becoming surgeons or electricians or mathematicians, but you still know these things. In today's high schools, in the 21st century, it's equally important for every child to learn how an algorithm works or how the internet works. Again, they don't need to become a software engineer. For the 90% of us who don't want to go in the field, this is just basic understanding of the world. This issue begins in K through 12. There's plenty of data that shows that children who get exposed to computer science in K through 12 are 6 times or 10 times more likely to study it in college. Surveys show that 9 out of 10 parents want their school to teach computer science. This isn't just white parents, it's not just wealthy parents, it's not just private school parents. 9 out of 10 parents want their children to study this in school, and only 1 in 4 schools actually offer the field. So there's a huge mismatch between what your actual population wants your schools to be teaching versus what the schools are actually teaching. So the real question is, can the public education system evolve? We started code.org 2.5 years ago with the audacious vision that public schools can evolve. And it wasn't something that people thought of as a, people weren't telling me, oh yeah, this is going to be easy. People actually told me you're completely crazy and public schools never, ever, ever change. But we've actually seen just in the last 2 years an amazing change in the public education system. For us, this started with a publicity campaign. The first thing I'd say is public schools have evolved over the years. We started with old tools and we've upgraded to new tools, and the question is what will succeed after that. We started by basically building awareness of the importance of this field with a campaign called the Hour of Code. The Hour of Code is a grassroots movement by 300 partners, 100,000 teachers, and it's a worldwide thing in every single country of the world. The point of the Hour of Code is to get schools, teachers, classrooms, students to try just 1 hour of this new field. And we started this 2 years ago. In 2 years, it's now reached every single country of the world. If you look in the United States, there's a massive density. Each one of those dots is a school that is having every one of their students try an Hour of Code. And this campaign happens during Computer Science Education Week from December 7th through 11th this year. We're gonna have a repeat of the campaign. The easiest thing anybody in government can do to help move the public education system on this front is to ask your schools to participate in an Hour of Code. The reason that's easy is because 1 hour is not a lot to give, and it's just a celebratory thing, and it gets teachers engaged in the field. People ask, how much can the Hour of Code get to? We've now had 130 million hours of code done in just the last 2 years. Much of that is kids going back and doing it over and over again. There's only 50 million students in this country. At least half of them have done the Hour of Code once, and many of them have done it multiple times. 48% of them are female, which is very different than the stats Linda mentioned of the women in the tech industry. We break stereotypes of computing by having girls in classrooms actually try this field and doing it in school. And the reason they're 48% female is because it's being done in regular school, not in after school or summer camps or at home where only the boys want to get involved. It's in regular school in a classroom that's 50-50 boys and girls. Now, an hour isn't enough to learn a field. What you really learn in an hour is that computer science can be fun. We offer puzzles and games with fun little characters and branded games. You also learn that coding isn't about typing and semicolons and little angle brackets. It starts with dragging and dropping commands to put together sort of just the flow of what you want a computer program to do. You don't need to learn about the semicolons or whatnot. And as a teacher, you learn that even your 12-year-old or 9-year-old kids can do it, and to produce a drawing like that can take only 10 minutes in writing code. And along the way, you can teach math concepts like the angles in a way that is a lot more exciting for the kid to generate that than to just answer a multiple choice question. And the most important thing that happens from the Hour of Code is teachers in schools realize that they can teach this field. The usual teacher, if you ask them, hey, would you like to teach computer science? They're like, no, how about the physics teacher? Whereas once they try the Hour of Code in their classroom, they see their kids love it, then they think, you know what, I can do more than this. And that's really the power of the Hour of Code, is building up the grassroots support to allow your states to also provide top-down policy change. So what happens after that hour of code? There's all these organizations, and mine is probably one of the largest one of them, helping bring full computer science classes to schools. Just to get back to the story, the two kids I mentioned, in Rahel's classroom in South Seattle, the entire school district has decided that every single school in the district should teach computer science. We've trained one teacher in every school to learn the field and provide them free curriculum. So she actually did enroll in a computer science class, and she's decided she wants to be a doctor when she grows up, but she wants to use technology to help kids, to help people and heal people. Armand's fifth grade classroom, the fifth grade teacher on her own decided to teach an hour of code. And from that first hour, she decided to look into the follow-on curriculum and has now put 20 hours of computer science for all of her fifth grade students. Armand's first goal in life is to become a Navy SEAL, but if that doesn't work out, his backup plan is to become a computer programmer. In terms of what's happened in the last few years, in only 2 years, over 300 organizations have joined forces to solve this problem. Over 70 school districts have embraced computer science, including New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, Miami, Las Vegas, Houston, and San Francisco. Those include all seven of the largest school districts in the country. 15,000 new teachers have been trained to teach CS in classrooms that didn't have it before. 85% of these teachers were women. Over 10% of all students in grades kindergarten through eighth grade have begun coding. That's a big change in just 2 years. And of them, 43% are girls. So this is a massive change in public education that's happening in the last 2 years. Also, 17 states have adopted new graduation policies, not to require computer science for graduation, but to allow it to count towards high school math and science requirements in graduation. Just to show a map of that, the gray states are the ones that don't yet allow computer science to count towards math or science graduation. We've had, there were only 10 good states just 2 years ago, now there's 27. But Louisiana, Mississippi, South Carolina, and West Virginia of the SGA states, those are the ones we're waiting on to change this policy. Some other things that have happened, just to say what states have done at a policy level. In Washington state, there was strong bipartisan support for legislation that was passed and signed just this year, funding retraining of existing teachers to teach computer science, providing $2 million over 2 years with a one-to-one private match, establishing standards for computer science, addressing teacher certification rules, and then also requiring that if you take a computer science class, it can satisfy a high school graduation credit in math or science. In Arkansas, the government made this actually part of his seven campaign promises, and legislation followed and passed, and we're hopefully going to hear about this in a little bit more detail in the next talk, so I'm not going to go through it in much more detail. In other states, Massachusetts has allocated $1.5 million a year in funding to expand computer science. Georgia has funded, I think, $250,000 a year for it, and there's efforts are underway in many other states. Computer science is now the fastest spreading course in public education. Schools that offer it see record enrollment by students. So this is the curve of high school students taking the AP computer science exam. It's the fastest growing course in this decade, in the 2010s. It's seeing 30% year over year growth in enrollment. However, that growth is happening in only 5% of America's high schools. 95% of schools don't teach this course. In the 5% that do, that's the graph of the students flocking to take the course. So we have a long way to go to get the other 95% of schools to at least give the students even the chance to enroll in this course. I'm just going to repeat the two graphs I showed you that are really important. 67% of all STEM jobs are in this field, and only 8% of our graduates are taking it. And 9 in 10 parents want their school to teach computer science, but only 1/4 of our schools are teaching it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hadi. That's very powerful to think that we can begin to make a difference just in the 1 hour of code. So thank you very much. Our next speaker is Anthony Owen. Anthony Owen is computer science coordinator of the Arkansas Department of Education. In this role, Mr. Owen serves as leader of Governor Hutchinson's Computer Science Initiative, to which the governor has allocated $5 million to expand computer science offerings, build teacher capacity, and expand workforce readiness for careers in computer science. Mr. Owen began his career as a high school and math and science teacher, and later served as a state lead curriculum writer for the Southern Regional Education Board and as Arkansas Department of Education's math and computer science curriculum specialist. Please join me in welcoming Anthony Owen.
Thank you, Ms. Hoke. Thank you, SGA, for allowing me to participate in these proceedings. Greetings from Governor Hutchinson. I am honored to stand here and represent Arkansas in this initiative and the progress that we are making. I do hate that I have to follow Mr. Partovi, though, because he's probably a lot more engaging than I am. However, we will. I wanted to share the words or at least some of the governor's thoughts with you all today. So I'm going to let the gentlemen in the back, if they'll roll this, and I will step out of the way.
Whenever you see hundreds of young people there excited about going back to school, but also perhaps having their first experience with coding, and with 70 laptops there and the students lined up 3 and 4 deep in order to get a chance at the laptop, it was just really exciting. You had volunteers there, and then the governor was there. I was there and I had my hour of code and I enjoyed every minute of it. Well, first of all, it's the language of the computer. And this is a skill that you need whether you are in technology or whether you're in agriculture or whether you're in manufacturing. These are skills that are needed to tell computers what to do.
For years, we've been talking about the advent of technology and using technology and being familiar with technology. But now students in Arkansas have the opportunity to go beyond that. They can start learning how to create the technology that are going to drive the economy, drive jobs for the 21st century and beyond.
Computer science is vastly underrepresented in minority and female populations. We need to encourage young girls, young men, minorities, all groups to be able to focus on STEM education. Computer coding is a significant part of that.
The governor's initiative, having this in schools where real kids can see real kids doing it and having fun doing it, is going to be the best thing that we can do to get more of them interested.
Don't let your situation keep you from taking this class. It is for everyone. While you're learning a language that can give you a skill later on for a career, you're learning thought processes and skills that are going to help you now within all of your classes and just life in general.
It's more about the critical thinking and the logic and the problem solving. The more that they can build that skill, the more they can adapt themselves to whatever job or opportunity presents itself.
No matter what field you decide to go into, if you have familiarity with computer coding, you're going to be in high demand in the future in any job. Arkansas students are going to have a leg up on students all over the nation.
Students need to take it. I would encourage them to take it, and they have the skills to do it.
Computer science will provide today's students with the skills, the experience, and the opportunities for the future that no other field can.
I will say that I tried to bribe the videographer to leave my portions out, but they wouldn't hear of it. When the governor came to me and asked me to step up into this role and appointed me as coordinator for computer science for the state of Arkansas, I told him, I said, well, you know, governor, as you know, nothing in education moves quickly, but with your support, we'll move it along as quickly as we can. And he didn't like that excuse, so I went to my other line as a computer scientist and said, well, as we uncover one problem, I hope you know what's going to happen. There are going to be 100 more pop up. And, of course, that's what we run into at a state level, but we are working through it. If you want detailed information, I'm going to kind of hit highlights. Please visit our ADE website. We have an entire section devoted to computer science. Has all this information I'm going to share today, plus much more that I will not have time. History of computer science in Arkansas. Really, we have three major educational entities, our Department of Higher Education, but K-12, we have two, Arkansas Career Education and Arkansas Department of Education. Our Career Education Authority, our department, has had authority over CS courses throughout, previous to really the focus of this initiative. However, beginning last year, we started to incorporate that or take that under the ADE umbrella by developing our first computer science and mathematics course. This past February, at the direction of the governor, we created a course called Essentials of Computer Programming, which is that entry-level course for high school students. Governor Hutchinson, as was said before, has made CS an emphasis for his campaign and continues to actively support it. As I go out and speak to individuals in Arkansas, I remind them this is not going away, not only because the governor has provided his support to it and his direction to it, but because, as Mr. Partovi has shared, it is a growing field and is growing exponentially. During the spring of 2015, Act 187 was passed by the legislature and signed into law. This required that beginning this school year, every Arkansas high school, public and charter, has to offer one computer science course that's approved by the department. And those courses are the previously mentioned Essentials of Computer Programming course, the Mathematics and Computer Science course, International Baccalaureate Computer Science, and AP Computer Science A. In fact, while I was at this meeting, we have, this was not in the slide, but we are going to announce within the coming weeks that we are going to add a fifth option for the 2016-17 school year. We are going to recognize the new AP Computer Science principals as meeting that requirement. In the spring of 2015, the SBE approved a change to our graduation requirements that allow a computer science flex credit to replace our graduation requirement of a fourth mathematics or a third year science. And actually, if a student takes two courses, they can replace both. Now, obviously, we have conversations with our schools that we want them to make sure that they're using this judiciously and that the students understand the full implications of it. If a student is going out, planning to go to a post-secondary institution as a chemistry major, we probably don't want them skipping their third year of science, which might be a high school chemistry course. But we do require six career focus credits for graduation, and CS can always count toward one of those. This rule is effective, or became effective immediately. To support the mandate, Governor Hutchinson did allocate a $5 million biennium allocation. We have provided over $1.6 million of that directly to schools, 90 schools, to start up the program. And I'll share a little anecdotal information on my drive up here. I made some school visits. That's part of that grant process, that I visit each school that received a grant. And I will tell you, I visited three schools in northeast Arkansas, Delta area of Arkansas. In fact, they were harvesting the cotton as I drove through right next to the school. And I had one principal that told me that they had a student that was going to drop out and become homeschooled, and the only reason they decided to stay in their public school was because of this new computer science course offering. It engaged him in work. It made school relevant for him. I had another school. Both these schools, by the way, have populations of fewer than 1,000, K-12. So it can happen in your rural districts also. But I had another school that had so many students wanting to take the course, and I cringed when the principal told me this, but they had to turn students away. And I said, you know, that's a travesty. Let's find a teacher. Let's find someone to sit in with those students. But that is something I'll get into just real quickly here in a minute. But we also seated a task force. Recommendations are coming forth in November. In fact, I was working on the document prior to this meeting that we're going to submit to the governor in November. We have over 1,600 students currently enrolled in a virtual system. We don't know how many students are face-to-face in face-to-face classroom environments because those numbers were due from school districts yesterday, and it takes our information services department a couple days to disaggregate that data. But we should have that data released through the governor's office around the 20th. We are optimistic. State focus continues to be on building awareness among communities, parents, students, industry, and other interested parties. Governor's CS tour, the videos that his office continues to produce. We have a CSTF awareness committee, and we have quarterly statewide and regional student coding events. In fact, I was speaking to Mr. Partovi earlier. We have over 200 eighth grade girls coming into the governor's mansion in December during the week of coding that will they'll participate in the hour of code, and we have regional events going on. So this is a continued effort by our state. Largest hurdle in most states probably is going to be the same as Arkansas, and that's finding certified and qualified teachers to teach these courses. So some of the things that we're doing, working with post-secondary programs, increasing clarity and flexibility in the licensure process. We, as a state, have set aside a portion of the $5 million allotment to pay for teachers' practice examinations. We're working with code.org to try to get ETS, and I would encourage all government policymakers here to sign on to this initiative. We need a computer science practice too, for that is developed multi-state. Currently, most states are having to use Texas's version of the praxis, and that puts us at their whim as they get ready to change that test. We have to accept those changes. So please sign on to that initiative as a state policymaker. I'm sure code.org can help give you some direction in that. But we desperately need a multi-state praxis too as a nation in computer science. We entered into agreement to provide lynda.com access to all Arkansas public school and charter school educators, and that is a technology online video company that produces courses in technology development, technology understanding, and our teachers can learn from there. Future of CS in Arkansas, and I'm over time, so I'm going to rush through this. Unless Ms. Hoke's going to kick me, I'll stop there. But I do want to share a little bit of our future. For the 2017 implementation or 2017-18 school year, we are developing K-8 computer science standards, and this addresses that disproportionate representation within computer science, because Arkansas is going to make it normal for everyone. And that is the only way that we're going to overcome those hurdles, is whenever it stops being a stigmatized subject area and it's normal for everyone, then everyone will be willing to engage. So we're going to have embedded K-8 standards in all of our other curriculum areas, K-8 computer science standards. We will have a coding block that is required, a unit of coding that is required for every Arkansas student in either 7th or 8th grade. And then at a high school level, we are developing a system of four-year course pathways. We really see computer science as three buckets: programming or coding, information security, and networking and infrastructure. So we will have pathways leading toward certifications, industry certifications, and opportunities for students in that. My contact information, Arkansas is always willing to share. In fact, I'm on my drive home this afternoon, I have a call that I'm sharing information with another state of what we're doing and how they can kind of follow after us. Before I sit down, I do want to take a moment to say something about yesterday's conversation about technology being disruptive. And, you know, I really thought about that after we left the meeting. And I think that we have to get away from that thought process. I think that we have to get away that technology disrupts our economy. Technology, causes problem for our economy. As we move forward, you know, especially in the southern states, we have to embrace the fact that technology is going to change. That is going to change the needs of our workforce, and we have to start looking at it as opportunities for how we can change our educational system and how we can change our policies within our state, not disruptions to the status quo. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. I know that your work in Arkansas will be an inspiration to other states that are here today, so thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Cheryl Schrader. Dr. Schrader is Chancellor of Missouri University of Science and Technology, and she's one of the few female engineers who has risen to a top position at a university in the United States. Since becoming Chancellor in the spring of 2012, Dr. Schrader has led a comprehensive strategic planning effort involving thousands of Missouri science and technology stakeholders. In 2013, the University of Missouri System Board of Curators endorsed Rising to the Challenge, Missouri S&T's Strategies for Success. And that plan sets the university's bold course for the next 7 years and beyond. Passionate about increasing interest in STEM education, Dr. Schrader's current research interests focus on creating and assessing innovative learning methods to help students of all ages succeed in STEM areas. Dr. Schrader is a recipient of a Presidential Award for Excellence in Science, Mathematics, and Engineering Mentoring from the White House, as well as many other honors and awards. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Cheryl Schrader.
Well, hello, everyone. It's wonderful to be here with you this morning. I very much appreciate this opportunity to talk about expanding participation in coding and computer science. So as mentioned, I'm one of the few female engineers who leads a research university, and you can imagine that I am very passionate about the topic that we're discussing today. Through my leadership at Missouri S&T, through commentaries in the media, through participation in international, national, and local organizations, such as the St. Louis Science Center Board of Trustees, I am helping to influence the public discussion on bringing more women into computer science, and frankly, into all of the STEM areas, the science, technology, engineering, and math disciplines. So events like this really help to shine the light on this critical issue. And again, I'm very thankful to have the opportunity to participate. As I'm sure my fellow panelists would agree, computer science, coding, and other related fields really are the gateway to not only high-paying careers, but also the chance to influence our increasingly software-driven society and the ability to truly make a world of difference. However, as we've seen, vastly more men than women are entering these fields. And while women receive more than half of the bachelor's degrees in, say, biological sciences, we see far fewer in the computer sciences, and it's about, on the average, 18%. In fact, computer science actually is the only field in science, engineering, and mathematics in which the percentage of women receiving bachelor's degrees has actually been rapidly decreasing. In 1985, which was just after I received my degree in electrical engineering, women earned 37% of computer science undergraduate degrees. And today, as we saw earlier, it's about half that. These fields are also limited, as was mentioned earlier, for underrepresented minorities, and some of these statistics might be interesting to you. African Americans account for 11% of workers overall, but only 7% in the computer science industry. Hispanics make up 15% of our workforce and only 6% of computer jobs. So the need, at the same time, for graduates in the computer industry continues to grow dramatically. About 50,000 US computer science jobs remain vacant every year simply because there are not trained workers to fill them. By the year 2020, nearly 760,000 new jobs in computing and information technology will be created. And that's according to the US Bureau of Labor Statistics. And so the real question is, how are we going to fill that gap? And the answer, of course, is that we need to provide other pathways to fill that gap. We need to attract those who've been traditionally underrepresented. So as Missouri's Technological Research University, we at Missouri S&T are doing our part to change these statistics. And our university is located in Rolla, Missouri. We were one of the very first universities in the nation to offer computer science instruction. And computer classes were offered by both the math and the electrical engineering departments in the early 1960s. Next week, actually, we are kicking off a year-long 50th jubilee for computer science. Our PhD program was launched in the 1970s. And a woman, Patricia McAdams, was the first person to receive a PhD from our institution in computer science in 1977. And she went on to a very long career at the University of Notre Dame in information technology. Our students can engage in these fields through our programs in computer science, in computer engineering, and also in information science and technology. And regardless of major, all of our graduates at Missouri S&T are STEM literate, and many of those majors recognize and incorporate computer studies into their curricula. So one great example are our business majors. Not only do they have a required business foundation, they also have a required IT foundation. and that makes them highly marketable. The average starting salary for those students is over $70,000. And they can be enterprise resource planners. They are experts in human-computer interaction as well. And they also have their general business expertise. So these graduates are very well prepared for the role that data and analytics plays in successful organizations. So in the past 10 years, our enrollment of women in computer science, computer engineering, and information science and technology has more than doubled, and that has outpaced our enrollment growth as a whole. We have active chapters of the Association for Computing Machinery Women and the Society for Women Engineers. We actively recruit in schools that serve underrepresented minorities and women, and that includes many of the parochial schools right here in St. Louis. We also have transfer agreements with schools throughout the United States that make it easy for students to transition to Missouri S&T. Our graduates go on to use their skills in a diverse array of companies such as Cerner and Boeing and Google. So we attribute our success to a number of factors, and I'm just going to talk about four of those. We have extensive summer camps that start with first graders. We offer camps all the way through 12th grade. We have about 18 different camps going on, and these include camps that are focused for women and also focused for underrepresented minority students. It turns out that 20% of our freshman class participated in one of those camps. We are Missouri's liaison to Project Lead the Way. And that means we've trained over 1,800 kindergarten through 12th grade teachers to help bring hands-on experiences in STEM into the classroom at a very early age. And we heard how important that is. And that includes computer science and computer manufacturing. One-third of our freshman class has taken at least one Project Lead the Way class. And on a related note, we now offer STEM credentials for those in elementary and secondary education, which of course means more gifted STEM teachers in the classroom. And all of our graduates in those areas also are qualified to teach Project Lead the Way. We host championships for FIRST Robotics and VEX Robotics, and about a quarter of our freshmen have competed in these competitions in high school. And also, what's very important is that we showcase diverse role models. We really are striving for a diverse workforce at all levels, and that includes faculty, staff, and administration. So an example is Dan Lin. She is an assistant professor of computer science, and she was the university's 2015 Woman of the Year. She teaches courses on cloud computing, pervasive computing, and also database systems, and does research in database systems and information security. And we tell stories that highlight a variety of students. For example, Markia Lewis, an African-American computer science major from St. Louis, has been featured in our university magazine and in our promotional materials. Now, she is also, by the way, majoring in Spanish, and she just came back from Costa Rica. And she also is a talented singer, dancer, and leader at Missouri S&T. And I tell you this because you may not be fully aware of how creative computer and information scientists really are. And that's a key to understanding how to recruit and retain folks, is to look for those places where the creative folks gather. So we also promote diverse role models through our Expanding Your Horizons annual event, and that's for girls in 7th and 8th grade. And we have about 700 girls who come to campus every year to tour the university, get the chance to meet professors and students and other role models, and participate in hands-on activities. And I've been very fortunate to greet them for a number of years, and I'm looking forward to our next event in November. So that gives you a little bit about the challenges that we're facing and how Missouri S&T is helping to to really fortify the pathways to computer science and related fields for all students. So in summary, I have just a few thoughts for you to ponder. The first is to make no mistake that an investment in STEM, an investment in coding and computer science is a direct investment to the economic vitality of your state. And here in Missouri, we are privileged that Governor Jay Nixon understands that connection. The second thing is when you're talking about education, consider that entire educational spectrum, and I like to call that K through gray, because you want to engage in hands-on activities throughout the educational spectrum in those fields, and that helps build not only the competence, but the confidence to move forward. We need to produce a technically literate citizenry that's prepared for careers we cannot even imagine using technologies that do not yet exist. And those educational experiences can be formal or informal, and we've seen examples of those already. The third is to be inclusive. Be inclusive in your thoughts and your words and your deeds, because we need to be able to bring those who've been traditionally underrepresented into these exciting fields. And be purposeful in encouraging and in highlighting the successes of women and underrepresented minorities all the way up the career ladder. And then finally, we understand that women are often drawn by outcomes. So we emphasize that it's not just about learning to code. It's about ensuring cybersecurity for all those who use the internet. And it's not just about crunching data sets, but it's about looking for patterns that can offer clues to understanding DNA abnormalities or to finding correlations between sleep patterns and the development of Alzheimer's. So with that, I'll conclude, and I'm very eager to hear from our next panelist.
Thank you, Dr. Schrader, for sharing with us some of the ways that our colleges and universities can help in this area, including the challenge that Anthony mentioned about training our teachers. Thank you. Our next speaker is Brendan Lynn. Brendan graduated with honors from Washington University in St. Louis, where he studied economics and founded not one, not two, not three, but four student organizations. In 2013, Brendan co-founded LaunchCode, a nonprofit organization helping local economies developing homegrown talent, create upward mobility, and build a 21st century workforce through apprenticeships and job placements in technology. LaunchCode has over 300 employer partners spanning across most of North America. Brendan has managed the organization since its inception and currently serves as its executive director. Please join me in welcoming Brendan Lynn.
Hey, pop that up there. All right, so Hadi showed us a graph, and on that graph there were 1.4 million jobs that were gonna be created in computer programming by 2020, and 400,000 CS grads. So that's a projected gap of 1 million jobs in computer science by 2020. That's massive. That holds back each and every one of your states. That holds back our country. At the same time, today, there are 9 million Americans who are unemployed, currently looking for work, and unable to find it. There's millions more that are stuck in cycles of low-wage job after low-wage job. You've got jobs. You've got people. How do you bring it together? Start with jobs, go to education, come back to jobs. How do people get jobs? The majority of people get jobs because of who they know, where they've worked, and a college degree. While in many ways those can help validate one's ability to get the job, they also highlight how privilege controls access to opportunity, how in many ways privilege begets privilege. Example. If you're born into the top 20%, the wealthiest 20% of families in this country, you have a 77% likelihood of graduating from college. If you're born into the bottom 20% of families, the poorest 20% of families, you have a 9% likelihood of graduating from college. That's 77% and 9% solely based on the socioeconomic status of one's parents. It's messed up. So what can we do to increase access to education? How do we change that? One, foundational, right? Like Hadi talked about. Computer science should be foundational, mandatory in public schools. Granted, we should also look at great programs like MSNT, right? That's consistently one of the greatest values in higher education in this country. So as states, public sector education, whether it's K to 12 or colleges, super valuable. There's also this crazy and awesome way in which the internet is truly changing the game for education. One example are MOOCs. So Harvard, they created edX in collaboration with MIT. They put on their introduction to computer science course, CS50. 200,000 people are currently taking that course all around the world for free. 200,000 people accessing world-class education from Harvard. It's offered in 63 different spoken, written languages, and it's free. It's a game changer. But what isn't a game changer is attainment, right? So 1% of those 200,000 people will end up passing that course. And of those people that do pass, if you take this class at Harvard, there's 120 TAs that help people get through this class. 120 TAs in one class. If you can sit at home and complete this class, which 1% of these people are doing online, like, that's insane. But then these people also aren't getting jobs. So when we started working with Harvard as run LaunchCode, when we started working with Harvard, they'd taken 866 people who wanted to get jobs out of online Harvard classes, multiple classes these people had passed, and they got zero of these people jobs over 6 months working with a team of recruiters, which is crazy. So our first thing was, how do we increase people that pass this class? What helps people get through this? And I'm horrible at moving slides. So we had this thing that was on the education. And then here's this, right? So we said, how do we increase the people that are passing these classes, and how do we let people know about these MOOCs? All right, so we worked with a bunch of employers at LaunchCode. We got people from these employers to say they would volunteer and help people through MOOCs. And the idea was, if you can give people a peer, if you can give someone they can talk to as they try to do a MOOC, then you might be able to actually increase the number of people who complete these things and increase the number of people who engage in communities. We announced that, okay, free MOOC, you could come take this at the public library. And 13 days later, we had 1,600 people at the Peabody Opera House that were looking to take a free semester-long class. That's free world-class education downtown St. Louis in an opera house. So that photo right there is an opera house where people are learning from Harvard online education. That's cool. And so we've worked on this, and we've massively increased the percentage of people who can complete this course by creating that ecosystem. So now it's more around 60 or 70% of people that we connect into this can end up completing this. But what hasn't changed until a moment later, one second, but what hadn't changed was people's ability to get a job. So someone could take this class and would find themselves potentially no more likely to get a job coming out of it than they would have otherwise, because it's not a credential, it's not a who you know, and it wasn't a previous employment experience. And so, like, ultimately that gets at the key idea behind LaunchCode, which is that hiring's broken. How do we know that hiring's broken? Well, because who you know matters. 40% of all jobs in IT come through a direct referral. Because where you went to school and how you learned matters as well. 94% of all job postings in IT require a bachelor's degree, right? That doesn't mean that, like, all the people who work in IT have a bachelor's degree. That doesn't mean that you need a bachelor's degree to do the job, but it means that first pass filter, unless you have a way in, is a bachelor's degree. And that's where we as an organization come in. So we started LaunchCode 2 years ago, and the idea was, we'll go to employers, get them to bypass their traditional hiring processes, and take someone on either as a direct hire or an apprentice who they wouldn't normally consider. Started as an experiment here in St. Louis, Missouri. Got 100 companies in 1 month. So we did this kind of blitz. We got companies from, oh man, slides. I gotta get these on autopilot. All right, so we had the hiring slide. And anyway, so then there's all these companies, right? So we got 100 companies in a month, right? From two-person startups to Fortune 500 companies. We said, take someone you wouldn't normally consider, you have these needs, put someone in these jobs. And we didn't know if it would work. We didn't even know if these companies would sign on. They signed on. They took on these people. They had a mentor in the company. The goal was for the company, a way for them to try someone they wouldn't normally consider before they hire them. For the person, is to get that bit of on-the-job experience that you really need that's beyond what you can learn outside of a workplace. And when we put someone into these apprenticeships in these companies, they typically last only 3 months. Within 3 months, the employer is making a decision on whether they want to hire the person or fire the person, and 90% of the time, they're hiring the person. What's crazy about this is it's not a program that's targeting one demographic or one group. We've gotten full-time jobs, good middle-class jobs for people aged 16 to 65. That's like, if you look at where tech is changing lives for people, it's not just changing lives for people in their 20s, it's changing lives for everyone in this entire economy, and figuring out how you get people of any background access if they have the potential to do the job is what we work to do. The people that we've gotten jobs for, half of them come in unemployed. For those that come in employed, 3 months later, they're making $33,000 more than they were previously. It's a 235% increase in one's salary solely based on access to a job that they could have done anyway, but they didn't have access to. So there's people, right? And ultimately, we're helping some people. So Terrence, what's Terrence's story? Terrence is here from St. Louis. He graduated from high school, didn't graduate from college. He went, he worked at FedEx Kinko's. He was at FedEx Kinko's for 10 years, making copies, sending packages. It wasn't his dream job, but it was the job he could get. What he really cared about was computer programming. At night, after work, Terrence would go home and teach himself how to code. He loved efficiency, he loved learning. Even at FedEx, he'd come in the morning and he'd think, how could I do my job more efficiently, more effectively, which is crazy. At FedEx Kinko's, he's making copies faster than anybody else, and that's like what he cared about. He did it for 10 years. And we got connected to Terrence, and the question was, okay, is Terrence someone who should be able to get access to his dream job? Is Terrence someone who could be a great computer programmer? Yeah, Terrence, while working a full-time job, taught himself how to code. Terrence was trying to every day do a better job where he was working. He's the kind of person who you want on a team, the kind of person who can learn what he needs to do the job. But like so many other people, Terrence found himself on the outside looking in. And he was one of our first people we got a job for through LaunchCode. So part of it is there's this idea of like, if you build it, they will come, right? So that was the same thing with the Harvard CS50 thing earlier, 1,600 people at the Opera House. When we did this, it was, you know, it's been highlighted before, women are less represented in tech. So the thought was, if we create, we take this Harvard curriculum, get the mentors, and we do it where it's run by women for women, what would happen? We had 300 women that showed up at a co-working space, and people were overjoyed, so that was great. And now every week, women get together in the Central West End here in St. Louis and teach each other how to code. And what we've seen from that is just by creating an environment that is for women, by women, we've seen a double, more than twice the increase in the number of women that we're getting jobs for, which is pretty cool. Another program that we've worked on, and this is in collaboration with the state here in Missouri, is Reboot You. So Reboot You was, how do we work with people who are long-term unemployed, get them access to quality education, and ultimately get them a job? And when we tried to start doing this, it was pretty unclear what would happen. The unemployment office said, well, the community college can't educate anyone, no one will pass. The community college said, well, no one from the unemployment office is gonna finish this class. And so we worked with the community college to further develop their curriculum. We worked with the unemployment office to develop screens for who would be effective in this program. And 27 people went into this class, and 82% of people ended up passing and getting connected to LaunchCode for an apprenticeship, which is pretty sick. And I'm gonna read you a letter I got last week. This is, Dear Brendan, LaunchCode has changed my life because it changed my husband's life. After almost 2 years of unemployment, getting into the Reboot You program last February gave my husband a renewed purpose, and this in turn gave me my husband back. I used to worry that whatever alternative career he ended up in wouldn't be as satisfying as his previous career. Well, I can tell you that after Reboot You and 8 weeks on the job as a software developer, I don't have that concern anymore. Your organization has far-reaching effects on the friends and families of LaunchCoders. My husband and I are a better, happier family thanks to LaunchCode. So from the bottom of my heart, I wanted to thank you and everyone at LaunchCode who worked so hard to help my husband find a new career. Sincerely, Lisa. So we live in St. Louis, and there's questions of, I mean, St. Louis has some troubles, right? So how do we increase access to these opportunities to more people? So again, we collaborated with like Chris Pieper and folks here at the state, and took a former state unemployment office building in North St. Louis, and October 29th, so 2 weeks from now, we're launching this program we're calling the Mentor Center. So it's basically a space where we're gonna house a bunch of different programs. We're bringing a boot camp from Chicago that's gonna offer tech education solely for youth of color. We have Coder Girl, we'll have the program for the long-term unemployed, and also anyone who wants to offer education classes or around tech in this community can come in, offer classes, and then we'll work to help people get jobs coming out of that. So we're doing that. And I said we launched 2 years ago here in St. Louis. In addition to what we've done here, we've also opened in Miami, and later this year we're opening in Kansas City and Rhode Island. So we're going to new places. Definitely something where we would be interested in exploring coming to your community. And then we're also generally interested in developing more connections with educators and employers to figure out how we can change this game everywhere, really. So it's not just us, though. I don't know if you guys know about Tech Hire. So President Obama announced this initiative in March called Tech Hire. The idea grew out of conversations we've been having with folks at the White House, and the thought was try to get these communities around the country to rally where you bring educators, employers together and create a pathway for people to get jobs. When he announced this program, he spent 4 minutes talking about one candidate, LaShawna Lewis, one of our candidates, who was from East St. Louis, had gone through Coder Girl, and ultimately got a full-time job with MasterCard. And President Obama summed up the work that we do, I think, pretty well when he said that the goal here is that if you can do the job, you should get the job. And that's what we work to do, is that basically it's great to ensure that people get the education they can deserve, but one way or another, it shouldn't matter what privilege someone comes from, but if they can get the skills, they're driven, and they can work with other people, they should have access to that opportunity. Thanks.
Thank you, Brendan, especially for talking about the importance of engaging the private sector in this challenge. This seems like the perfect opportunity, talking about the private sector, to acknowledge the work of one of our private sector sponsors, IGT. Through their after-school advantage program, IGT has helped to bridge the digital divide by sponsoring computer labs for underprivileged children in partnership with schools, nonprofit organizations, and faith-based organizations in the states that they serve. In January of 2016, the company will open their 10th after-school advantage program in the state of Missouri. This represents an investment of almost $250,000 in the past 20 years. The Southern Governors Association and Governor Nixon want to recognize IGT for their commitment to bringing diversity to the information technology workforce of the future. I believe there's someone here from IGT. Thank you very much. Well, I know the panelists' presentations have brought a lot of questions to my mind, but I want to give the opportunity to engage you in the discussion as well. So we do have a few minutes to engage our panelists in conversation. I want to see if there are any issues that you would particularly like to hear from our panelists about. Yes.
Code.org, who presented some of the same information, and clearly your organization is leading the way. I wanted to say that Missouri, we're proud to say, does count computer science as part of the math core, and I believe it's an elective for science. But one of the areas where we can certainly improve is advanced placement. Only less than 2%, I think, of the advanced placement classes in Missouri are computer science related. So while we've done that threshold work of making it count in the core, we certainly do need to up our game in advanced placement.
Yeah, the hardest
the hardest problem, I think, for all states in the country, and Arkansas, frankly, it's amazing, is completely leading the way for the country in this field. The hardest problem is the lack of teachers in the field, which as a result means schools that simply don't teach it. It's hard to move the AP computer science numbers when 95% of schools don't offer the course. This isn't about the students not wanting to take the course. You know, when I went to high school, computer science was for the super nerds. It was the geekiest course. You wouldn't want to be caught dead taking this class, and you didn't want to, you know, it just was an antisocial field. That's completely changed for today's kids. They all look at their role models or people like, you know, the guy who made Snapchat, and they see these people becoming billionaires, and then they don't see themselves getting there because there's not a single course in their school that leads them down that path. But the, you know, and in a time when, you know, we see our country struggling with poverty and inequality, it's just such a shame that 75% of our schools don't even offer one course towards this field that leads to literally the best paying jobs in the country. But the way to turn that around is about providing teaching capacity in schools. And the cheapest way to provide teaching capacity in schools is retraining existing school teachers who are already certified, already in the classroom, already teaching something else. And it takes not too much money. It takes somewhere between $5,000 and $10,000 to retrain an existing high school teacher to be able to teach enough computer science. And you can do the math if you count the number of high schools in your state, multiply by $10,000, that's roughly how much it costs to bring computer science to every single school in the state. And it's an amazingly efficient way of changing the education system. If you want to hire new teachers, that's a whole nother deal. You know, a new teacher is gonna cost $120,000 or so per school. But for one-tenth of that cost, retraining the existing staff is the most impactful thing to do. It requires funding more so than graduation laws do, but it's the funding that I believe will pay for itself quite quickly.
Are there other questions? Yes.
I completely agree with and appreciate all the work that you all do. I mean, it's really phenomenal. Here's my question, and because you mentioned, Hadi, that you started with a Commodore 64. I remember when Fortran was kind of the Bible in college computer science classes. What do you say to the people who, the naysayers out there who would say, well, you know, if we invest in all this, or if I invest my time in learning this particular way of coding, it's going to be obsolete in 4 or 5 years or even sooner. So, you know, it's just not worth the effort. How do you address that argument that with the dynamic nature of technology and the acceleration of change, that it's, I mean, I think it's self-evident why we would invest in this, but what do you say to those naysayers to say, well, you know, it's going to change anyway, so why do it right now?
Well, I'll go ahead and take a crack at that. When you learn coding, when you are exposed to computing studies of any kind, you really learn a thought process, a way to think. And I believe people were mentioning it's logic. And so those are foundational, regardless of what particular tool or language or technology you are going to use. And frankly, when I was talking about having a technically literate citizenry, we need to have people who have that logical thought process, who can problem solve, regardless of what it is they're addressing, whether it's a social issue, a technical issue, or something else. So if we focus on being able to provide resilience in our educational system, that will have people be able to understand and perhaps develop the new technologies to go into careers that we haven't even thought of yet. So I hope that might help address the naysayers, is you don't teach a particular tool per se, but you teach a thought process and an ability to adapt as things change around you. And they will change very, very quickly.
Yeah, I have an answer on this, which relates to whether you're teaching it at a foundational level or vocational. If you want to teach a vocational course like how to build iOS apps, that's only going to, you know, be targeted for people who want to get jobs getting iOS apps. When we talk about K through 12 instruction, what we teach in the curriculum that we produce and what states like Arkansas and others are adopting teaches much more the foundational concepts that have stayed the same since the days of Fortran, Pascal, C, C++, Java, JavaScript, Ruby, PHP. These languages come and go, but the actual concepts in them are the exact same concepts. Things like how one instruction can be looped, or how a computer makes decisions using if-then statements, or how it stores data and how it analyzes data. The words in the different languages change, but the actual concepts are the same. Most people also, when they hear computer language, they compare to, you know, I learned Spanish or French when I was in high school. When you learn a spoken language, there's literally 100,000 or many 100,000 words in a language like French or Spanish. There's a lot of memorization. Your average computer language has maybe 200 words. If you've learned one computer language, learning the next one takes about 3, maybe 4 weeks. You may not be the master of it, but enough to basically get going and do it. So if you teach any computer language from a programming standpoint, even though the language has changed, switching from one to the other is just fine. When I graduated from college, my very first job, I needed to learn a new computer language I had never learned before. And literally by week three, I think just during the summer as I was getting ready for the job, I read a book and I was well on my way. And it's because the languages are literally 200 words. You just figure out what's the words in this one.
I'll add to that that I did start with Fortran. And then I ended up teaching C and Pascal, not having ever had any formal instruction in it. But once I learned Pascal, then it took me a Sunday afternoon to master the basics of C.
And I think one thing you hit on is just kind of how quickly things are changing, and everything's always changing. And so what's the most important things to learn? Some of the foundations, but also really just that ability to teach yourself how to learn and to kind of be a lifelong learner. And so the process of learning something today and realizing that you have to learn something new tomorrow to kind of remain relevant in your ability to do things, to remain employed, is a skill that's as crucial as anything else. Because if at some point you say, well, this is going to change in 4 years, I don't want to do it, you're going to be even further behind in 20 years.
I think we have time for one final question. Are there any other questions from the group? Okay, well, let me leave the panel with one final question then. Since governments don't have unlimited budgets, what one thing would you suggest that we should do to get started in terms of making the biggest difference in the South in this challenging area? So if each of you might have an idea to share, that would be great, and take us off with that idea.
Sure, I have a simple answer. If you have one thing to spend money on, it would be retraining existing K through 12 teachers to teach computer science. Not just because it's important, because it's highly cost effective. The ROI on that is so much higher than hiring new teachers or almost anything else. It roughly amounts to $10 per student impacted is the cost, which is so, so cheap.
From a K-12 perspective and what Arkansas is doing within its initiative is that we are, you know, at a high school, I think Mr. Partovi is exactly right. Retraining those teachers is crucial to the work. But I also think at the K-8 environment that we have to stop treating computer science as a separate entity. Your teachers are already teaching computer science. They just don't know they're teaching computer science. Your math teachers are teaching analytical skills that are used within computer science thought processes every day. They just don't know it. Your students are performing tasks that are computer science-oriented tasks every day within your schools. They just don't know it. So I think in a broader context, at that K-8 environment, we have to start having those discussions and making those connections between those computer science concepts and our math, our ELA, our science, our library media services standards and student learning objectives. We have to make those connections and show teachers, you are computer science teachers. I met with a computer science summit a couple weeks ago, and we were talking about it, and we were talking about the new K-8 standards that Arkansas is working on and going to adopt. And I told them, you know, when we adopt those, every teacher within this room is going to be a computer science teacher, because all of our teachers will then be required or responsible for computer science instruction. And they're already doing it. And when I showed them they were already doing it, they were amazed. But just by calling those concepts and relating them to computer science, I think we bridge that gap. And then, you know, our our state looking at that coding block at the seventh or eighth grade as a requirement for every student. I just go back to, and every time I speak to the governor of how excited I am that we are going to take that stigma away that computer science is only for one demographic or a couple demographics, that in Arkansas we are going to make it normal for every student. It would be abnormal for a student not to have computer science in Arkansas.
Well, I would agree with my colleagues here on this panel that I think one of the most cost-effective ways that we can address some of the critical workforce shortages, but also provide the literacy that's needed in this 21st century, is to train the teachers. And we have found that Project Lead the Way has allowed us to bring in teachers, most who are post-service, so they are already teachers and are coming back to get some specialized training in computer science or biomedical sciences or engineering, for example. This is a strong public-private partnership that runs Project Lead the Way. Many, many corporations around the United States are providing funds that help the schools themselves create the laboratory and hands-on and computer experiences so the teachers can bring that experience to the students. I think that also paying attention to what we've heard here, that start people early. And when you provide those hands-on experiences, particularly it draws in more women and underrepresented minority students, and they have that ability to understand that they can do it themselves. And I think that confidence is what we'll see more women and underrepresented minorities coming into computer science and into some of the STEM areas. And then the other thing I think to pay attention to is not to continue to expand the digital divide. So being able to reach teachers in schools that serve the lower socioeconomic classes is very important, and sometimes it's those schools that don't have the money to send the teacher $5,000 expense to get the Project Lead the Way training, or they may not have the ability to have those computer labs. So if we can figure out from the state perspective how we can support some of these nationally known programs and very effective programs, I think that would be a great investment.
If we agree that computer science is foundational, then I think there's a question of why isn't it a requirement at all steps of education? And so in Arkansas, they have to teach computer science in schools. As government, you can kind of stipulate different things. And it seems like if somebody goes to college, no matter what they study, having them graduate with the skills to potentially work in as a computer programmer is something that should happen. So when Cheryl talked about the business school grads that are also trained in computer programming, that's cool, that's innovative, and that's responsible, right? You're not just graduating people. I think it's awesome that there's liberal arts. I think it's awesome that there's all these different fields, but complement that with a 21st century education. And if you require foreign language, if you require all these different things, why doesn't every college require the amount of education in computer science that could get someone at least some kind of job in computer programming? And if we look at our K-12, it's why don't those schools require that someone that is graduating from high school has at least the foundational skills to, you know, if not work in tech, be successful in college in a computer science pathway?
I wanted to say another comment about the funding thing. Just, you know, whether it's at the high school level or at the elementary school level, every state has a budget for professional development of teachers. You don't necessarily need to make new money available. You can, in many cases, make your existing budgets for professional development say, this part of that needs to go towards this. And what's interesting there is most times when you do professional development of teachers, it's hard to show the return. If a teacher's taught math for 10 years, giving them another 2 weeks of professional training, is that going to move math scores up or down? It's not clear. But if a teacher's suddenly teaching a course that was never even offered before, you can clearly measure one less school that doesn't teach computer science. In our country, there's only one state now that has decided this has to be taught in every school and every child is going to get a coding block. The United Kingdom has decided the entire country is going to do that. South Korea, just in the last 2 years, the entire country is doing that. Saudi Arabia, just in the last 2 years, the entire country is doing that. Australia, just a few weeks ago, has decided to do that. Italy and Germany are looking to do the same thing. So all of those countries have just done this in the last 2 years. We have one state right now leading the country, and hopefully we can get the rest on board.
Well, unfortunately, our time has come to an end, but I know that our panelists have left us with a lot of great ideas going forward. So please join me in thanking our panelists for their excellent comments today. Thank you.